Welcome to Gray Matters. We're happy to have you with us today. We're very excited because in this month of August, we are now in our new senior center. The new senior community center is open at 68 Elm Street, and we invite you all to come down and take a walk through and check out all the wonderful spaces. And with me today is Dr. Afridi, and Dr. Afridi will be speaking with us at the end of August on a Friday, and the date eludes me, but I think it's right around the 20th we're going to have you, but check out the newsletter. And you're going to be talking about cardiac health, and that's what we're here to talk about today.
Absolutely.
So tell us a little bit about yourself. You're a physician with a primary focus.
Yes. So I'm a physician who is board certified in internal medicine, and I'm also a cardiologist, and I'm also a public health researcher who likes to work in very low-income communities to prevent heart disease. So I have three roles. One, to treat people with heart disease, guide people in preventing heart disease, and then figuring out models of intervention where people can least afford to prevent or treat heart disease.
Oh, that's awesome. I love public health. I think it's a wonderful field, so that really captures me. But as we move forward, you know, we are the senior center, so we're facing the people who are a little bit older adults, mature, who often are faced with heart disease. So tell us about that. What are we looking at a lot of times?
So as you know, with aging comes several problems, and the most important one is mobility. And our elderly population is less mobile. Their metabolisms are slower, so whatever they eat doesn't really move much. And the biggest issue is the accumulation over the years of risk factors for heart disease, which is that they have high cholesterol, high blood pressure, their weights are slightly high. So they have a collection of factors that makes it much easier for them to have consequences of their lifestyle, which is developing diabetes, high blood pressure, that leads to heart attacks, strokes, and heart failures. So those are the things that face our 70-year-olds and our 80-year-olds, and sometimes our 60-year-olds. And those are the things that we all have to grapple in figuring out what is the best way to educate them, and how do you get them to understand that it is in their hands to prevent disease, and it is in their hands to promote health for themselves.
And I think that's where that public health piece comes in.
Yes.
And working with that, you know, lower income is that, you working with a younger population, you're trying to say this is what could happen when you get older, and we've proven that it can happen. So let's help you change your lifestyle now.
Yes.
By not smoking and eating the right foods. And, you know, I know going to the grocery store, shopping for a family of four, it's hard to buy, you know, you spend $140 and you try and buy as healthy as you can, but it's expensive.
Yes.
You know, and that's where I think, you know, we offer a lot of programs to the seniors where it's like the brown bag, which is through the Boston Food Bank for the healthier foods, and they can get food stamps and things like that. So, you know, it must be interesting to look at people through the lifespan.
Yes.
of trying to help prevent it and then treat it.
So I think you've touched some very key points, which is that the disease at the end is very expensive to treat, and there are certain behaviors and risk factors that can be worked on to prevent heart disease. And this is what I mean by that exercise, abstinence from tobacco, and eating right are the three pillars where you have to focus on. Exercise doesn't mean that you have to spend $10 or $20 or $100 in a gym. Exercise simply means walking. And the other thing is diet, which doesn't mean that you have to abstain from eating. It's just you have to make the right choices. And then the third thing is tobacco. Obviously, it just increases your risk by 10, 20 folds of getting heart disease or strokes. and other vascular problems in the legs, so that the legs hurt when you walk around. So then the question arises, how do we do this in a budget that is only $150 for a family of four or a family of three? And this is a little bit tricky, and that is where the local governments come in and help out. That is where being able to go to these markets, these family markets, or these weekly
community
food
farm
places.
Shares,
yes,
yeah.
That is where we need to develop these programs where you'll be able to buy stuff such as fruits and vegetables.
And you know, it's interesting you say that. August 10th, we are going to, for the first time, we are getting 75 vouchers to farmers markets for seniors. And there is an income guideline, and anybody can call the senior center to find out, but it's the first time that our area is going to be offering this, you know, and it's $25 to go to free a farmer's market to get some nice, healthy, fresh produce that's grown locally.
Absolutely. I think this is a great thought. It should be the pilot. But remember, there are far more people than 150 who need assistance and support. So I think in the end, we will all have to figure out what is the best way that we prevent disease in our 70-year-olds and 80-year-olds, and what are those programs that truly cater to them, that provide them the nutritious food and prevent them from buying stuff that is easy to get and cheap, but that is laden with cholesterol and saturated fats, which makes them even more sick because they're also loaded with salt that raises their blood pressure, that causes them to have, you know, all sorts of diseases. So these are very sort of important points that we have to figure out as a community. How do we figure this out for our 70-year-olds and 80-year-olds to prevent the disease from happening? But there's one thing that I would emphasize. There's nothing better than walking. So if you really wanted to prevent heart disease, all you have to do is, if you have an exercise bike and you have arthritis, just sit on it and pedal 10 minutes, 15 minutes, 20 minutes. Or if you can walk, then go out for the walk. If you can get 1,000 steps, 2,000 steps in a day, that's all what you need to stay fit. And I'm going to quote a very interesting study. So they wanted to know, what's so different about these 90-year-olds? How come they reach 90-year-old and they're still walking, and there are people at 70s who are just bedridden? It turns out that there's only one thing, not medicines, not doctors, not tests. There's only one thing that helps you get to your 90s in a healthy way, and that is walking.
You know, and it's such a simple thing, and yet we all try and fight for that front parking spot in front of the grocery store, don't we?
Yes.
Instead of taking that back one that's a little bit further away. And I think that's sort of the mentality that we need to change. And moving forward, I think one of the great things in our new senior community center as we open this month is we have a treadmill. You know, Doreen Brothers, our outreach worker, is very, you know, she's big on fitness. She's had you out to talk before. And she's like, we have to have a treadmill. So the treadmill is there. It's in the building. It's set up. We encourage people. And we connect to the Riverwalk.
Yes.
So that people can walk down, you know, connect up to the Riverwalk, walk back. We get water. We got restrooms. We got all, everything you need. So no reason for no walking.
Outstanding work.
Yeah.
One thought that I had in this would be that at that age, people, issues are more than just treadmill, they're balance issue there. So if they could, somebody would donate, or a community would get together to get an exercise bike where people would just sit and pedal.
Yeah.
And if people with severe lower extremity arthritis, if they could have these ergonomic hand bicycles where they could sit and just get some exercise done with their arm, because they can't walk, it hurts to walk and all that. So I think those would be some important contributions.
I think we're going to get one.
So I think those would be things that I would be looking, if I were an 80-year-old and if I really wanted to be healthy, I want to know who's out there who could just pitch in and help me out a little bit.
Okay, so I know what you're talking about. They're a tabletop bike.
Yes.
You see them a lot in the rehab. So we'll get at least one of those at the senior center. Now, what about an incumbent bike? We're looking at getting one of those.
Yes.
So
that would be very helpful for people with back pain, because that allows them to support their back and yet get their legs up and pedal. So it is quite helpful for our 70-year-olds and 80-year-olds with some back problems.
Right. And the other thing you had mentioned was the balance. And I know we offer the Matter of Balance programs, but some of the other things is we had gotten a grant a while back for foot care and podiatry. And one of the things that I'm trying to push is that we will help you buy those higher end sash shoes that are more, you know, are better for your feet, give you that stabilization. So if somebody out there is a Amesbury senior and they have those needs, they just need to call me and we'll even buy them for you. So there's really not a reason, you know, as long as you're low income, we'll go ahead and help you out there.
These are just, I mean, I'm so happy that you're mentioning all this. But one thing that I would also emphasize is the screening of our elderly, our 70-year-olds and 80-year-olds, because they're out there, they have balance issues, they have foot issues,
right.
And there should be these little clinics where they would say, okay, fine, get your feet checked for problems and get your balance assessed, whether you are at a risk of low-risk fall or are you at high-risk fall, and what can be done to help our elderly or our 70 or 80 years old to say, if you are at a high risk, then you need this set of exercises. And if you are at a low risk, you need these set of exercises. I believe if we could just somehow come up with these models, and I'll help you with this. I will be the first person to do that.
Right. Well, I know that Elder Services offers that chronic disease and self-management program, but they also have one called the Matter of Balance, and it is all about the balance. And that's a Stanford-based program, so it's the evidence-based programming. So those are things that we can start bringing more into this new senior community center because we're going to have the space.
Oh, this is just absolutely amazing work.
It is. Yes. And so I want to talk. So now we have somebody current day, right now living, who's in their 70s and 80s with heart disease. So what are we going to do? You know, we've sort of talked a little bit about the prevention, but how are we going to move forward and what are some of the treatments we're looking at?
So the first thing you want to do is metrics. How do you know if you're healthy or not? That would be the first question I would ask. I ask any of my 70-year-old and 80-year-old. So how do you know you're healthy? So the first thing I do is I always get their height and weight. And I calculate something called a BMI, which is the body mass index. And I know that whether they're overweight or obese or underweight or normal weight. So that's the first thing I assess. So that's what I would do, the number one. Number two, I ask them about their exercise habits. And I try and gauge what are they capable of doing and what are they doing normally and how much are they moving. So those would be the metrics that I assess. And the third thing that I assess is their eating habits, where they're buying their food, what's in their refrigerator, how much salt intake they're having, how much fat intake. So I get these three metrics upfront. And obviously, if they are using tobacco, I get that sense from them. But most of these people have quit smoking by the time they're in their late 70s, 80s, especially because of the cost of smoking is sort of called prohibitive now.
Which is good.
Yes, which is very good. The second thing that I do is I do some what I call a biochemical basis of how well they're doing in terms inside their body, which is what are their cholesterol levels, what are their sugar levels. And then I ask for some symptoms. Are they having actually disease right now? And I screen them for the disease, basically. And the way I do that is I ask some very simple questions. When you walk, do you have chest pressure or heaviness? Or do you get winded easily, especially if you go up a hill? Or do you develop swelling of your legs? And if the answer to some of these questions is yes, then I quickly take them to the next level, which is I test them. And I test them if they are able to walk on a treadmill, or if they're not able to walk, then I do what we call a chemical stress testing to assess what is the state of their heart. Are they very near having a heart attack, or their hearts are superbly fit and I don't need to worry about them? So stress test allows me to do that. The second test I do is I just look at
So when they talk about stress, you're not talking about like the stress they've had moving in. You're talking about the physical stress on the strain on the heart.
Yes, we want to know how the heart would do if they were under a stressful situation. So if they were trying to catch a bus, or if, you know, they were upset at somebody at home, you know, they were angry, upset, somebody didn't do something right, that the body puts out hormones called adrenaline. Adrenaline goes and impacts the heart and makes it beat faster, elevates the blood pressure. But if the heart is already at the margin, at the borderline, then you start having chest pain, then you start having heart failure symptoms. So that is what a stress test does. It allows us to find out what is the fitness of the heart at that stage. And remember, these engines, the hearts, have been around for 70 years and 80 years. So how many machines are out there that work so well? that are out there, 70, 80 years, right? Yeah. Our cars go away after 10 years best, or 15 years at best, unless we take superb care of them.
Right.
Right? And remember how well we take care of our cars?
Yeah.
Every 6 months, oil change, engine check, this check, that check. How many times we check our heart throughout our lives?
Right.
Unless somebody tells you, or if you have a symptom, nobody checks their hearts. And these are one of the most critical structures in the body, because without the heart, either you go away or you get sick enough that people are taking care of you.
Right.
So that is why it is important to do those tests. So from some very basic metrics to biochemical metrics, such as your sugar, your levels, your cholesterol levels, to testing your heart directly. What is the strength of the pump? How your valves are functioning? How well would your heart perform under stress? So those are the different things we can look at when somebody, a 70-year-old comes to me, or an 80-year-old comes to me. But more importantly, you want to put it together in a way that they are able to then make decisions for themselves. Because I can talk the gibberish of my cardiology and it will just fly over their head.
Right.
But I have to really simplify to say, okay, what do you need to do to prevent this from happening? I think that is where the role of a good cardiologist comes in.
Right. And how can, you know, let's look at the positive ways. You can go to the Annmary Senior Community Center and use your treadmill, and it's not going to cost you anything.
Yes.
You know, things like that. Now, so talk to me about a cardiac cath. What is a cardiac cath?
So there are certain patients, and most of them are in their 70s, 80s, and 90s, where the blood supply to the heart starts getting blocked. So now they're actually having symptoms of heart disease: chest pain, heaviness, chest pressure, swelling of their legs, shortness of breath when they walk or climb upstairs. And that leads to a stress test, and the stress test shows that there is a blockage. So then you want to know, is this something that I can fix or not?
Mm-hmm.
Or is it something that we can let go and we say we can't do much? Because there are patients who say, Dr. Afridi, you know, I've lived a good life. I really don't want to do anything. Just give me some medicine and let me go home. So there are those set of people.
Right.
And then the other set of people who say, Dr. Afridi, you know, I have to do this, that. I really don't want these symptoms. I've got so many things to do.
I got to go to Alaska. I got to go to Hawaii.
Yes, absolutely. So then what we do is we take a direct look into the heart by a procedure called coronary angiogram, or cardiac catheterization as we call it. And we do that at Anna Jake's Hospital, our very own hospital, very nearby. So you don't really have to go very far to get it done. And the way we do that is through a large vessel in the groin, and now we can do through an arm blood vessel, radial artery. We pass a catheter into the heart and locate the openings of these blood vessels and inject a contrast. And we are looking on the camera over the screen where you can see all these blood vessels lining up. So if the blood vessel doesn't have any blockages, then the flow is beautiful and crisp. But if there's a blockage, you see a little bump that there's flow, there's no flow, and then there's a little trickle down. So right away you know that this is the blockage, and that's probably...
Now, are you videotaping this as it goes through so you can go back and watch it?
Absolutely.
And that, so if you can bring it to it when you do your presentation, we can watch it?
I could show you that
in so
many beautiful ways.
Yeah.
But then you say, okay, fine, we know that there is a blockage, and we can fix it through the groin or through the, through the arm by putting what we call a device called a stent.
Mm-hmm.
And this, what it does is that it's like a scaffolding. A balloon goes in, dilates the blood vessel, and then we go in and put this device, a metallic scaffolding, that keeps that area opened.
Okay.
And that's called a stent. So by doing this, now you have prevented an impending heart attack. And by doing this, you have taken care of the symptoms that the patient was having, that shortness of breath with exertion or walking, the chest tightness that they were having as they were moving. And interestingly, I want to mention this, because what happens to the 70-year-olds and 80-year-olds, because they're getting these symptoms, they don't like it. And they're not telling it to anybody. So automatically, do you know what they do?
What?
They stop walking, because they know that the seventh step they take, the tightness in the chest is going to come in. They don't like it, so they will go and sit. And if you ask them, are you having chest pains or shortness of breath?
No.
They say, no, I'm not having anything.
I see that all the time. No, I'm fine. I'm like,
but what's actually happening is that they're not moving enough to get to that point where they're having the symptoms. And that's what we have discovered now, and we actually push them to give that information away.
Right, and I can see that happening, you know, now that you pointed out, because people don't want to say anything because they're afraid. You're going to take me to the hospital, you're going to do all this. But if it's something that's treatable, you know, and, you know, on the seventh step, it's hard. You know, once you treat it, they're back to doing, you know, hopefully their previous level of functioning.
Absolutely. And one sort of the bad product out of all this is that they don't move, they get extremely deconditioned. So even if you take them after, say, a year of being so deconditioned and open their blood vessel, they really need to go to a cardiac rehab. They need to get exercise.
And Anna Jakes has a cardiac.
Anna Jakes has a one of the finest programs that I've ever seen for cardiac rehabilitation. They do just a tremendous job mm-hmm. in getting people from being not able to do much to being able to independent. I've seen this over the past 10 years, and I would vouch for that program.
Yeah. So, and that's a great, you know, local mm-hmm. resource, and
absolutely,
you know, we can help people figure out how to get there and back. So, and then you have a practice locally that
yes.
people can see you, which is in Newburyport, and I know we're gonna, you know, pop up all your information so that people can contact you. And you see people at Anna Jakes, and you also go to Merrimack Valley Hospital.
I do. Yes.
So, you know, you go to both of those local hospitals. If you had any, you know, some words of wisdom for those people who are out there watching that might be in their 70s or 80s that are having, or older, 90s, that are having some, you know, they're listening and they think, well, maybe, you know, I should, you know, look into this. You know, should they give their primary care physician a call? What are some of the things that people should look for as they're looking at cardiac issues? And mm-hmm. There's all these terms, CHF, cardiac heart failure. What, besides the fatigue, what are other things that people might see?
So these are very important questions. And if I were a 70-year-old, an 80-year-old, the last thing I would want to do is leave my comfortable environment mm-hmm. and go to an uncomfortable environment of a hospital or a doctor, having to drive to a place, having to change my schedule. So there are these competing issues that prevent me from really paying attention to my symptoms. So although I'm having the symptoms, I would rather not address them right away, and I would wait till something bad would happen. So this mindset has to be challenged. That's number one. Number two would be, what are these symptoms? So if you have a blockage, then you can have pain in the chest, pain in the arm, pain in the neck or the jaw. If you walk, you can get winded easily. So you were able to walk from here to your mailbox, but now you're struggling. That's a sign of heart disease. Don't ignore that. The other thing is that if you're developing swelling of your legs, and I know almost 80% of my 70 and 80 year old have some form of swelling of the legs, then I would not ignore these symptoms. Swelling of the legs has to do a lot with the heart, that either the heart is under strain or the blood pressure is too high, and both these issues need to be addressed. So if you're having swelling of your legs, windedness with walking, especially at night if you're getting up short of breath, especially if some chest pain wakes you up at night, then don't ignore these symptoms. These are the symptoms of heart failure, and these are the symptoms of an impending heart attack. So you don't want to have a heart attack to come into the hospital.
Right.
You have to come in early so that you prevent that from happening. Remember, the cost of that is extremely high, such that many of us go into bankruptcy when we have a heart attack or a stroke. So you really don't want to wait, because the cost to you is very high, the cost to your wallet is very high, and some of the other things that you have to keep in mind are that what we call peripheral vascular disease now.
Right.
That when you walk, you get these cramps behind your hips or your thighs or in your calves. That is an early sign of blockages in the blood supply to the leg muscles. And that is what we call peripheral vascular disease, or disease of the blockages of the blood supply to the muscles of the legs. They are very important to note, because these are fixable. You can actually fix these problems with a small hole in the groin. They put a stent in, and the symptoms disappear with very minimal risk to you. And I don't want to sort of overemphasize the minimal risk because there can be bad cases also, but most of the time the outcomes are superb. So those would be the signs that I would look for. And finally, strokes and pre-strokes. They again, blood supply to the brain. There may be a blockage in the right side of the neck or the left side of the neck. And the symptoms are simple. Dizziness for no reason at all. Visual changes. Weakness or numbness in the arm or the leg. Balance issue that suddenly happened. You walk and you're sort of drifting to the left side as you get up out of the bed in the morning. Don't ignore these symptoms. Call your doctor right away. These may be the early signs of a stroke, and you can prevent a major stroke from happening by a simple aspirin or by small medicines that we can do. But you need to come right away to take care of these things. Very important.
Right, because stroke is a huge thing that is, as we age, that we're at risk of. So, you know, I know medications with the new Medicare Part D can be quite challenging, I'm sure, for on your end, because you want to give your patient a certain med, and then they say, well, it's not covered, you know. And I think that people need to realize that, you know, with, you know, your physician, with you, or whomever's treating them, and there are other ways out there to get the medications that they need. You know, they need to come to us, they need to talk to other people, and there are resources out there to help pay for those meds. You know, I know we get grants for that, because the meds can get expensive, and I think that's one of the things that people fear. And we have SHINE counselors, which are serving the health information needs of elderly. So if you have somebody that comes to you and says, you know, half the drugs you want me to take aren't on my plan, then they need to come to us and they need to meet with the SHINE counselor, who can then say, all right, let's look at getting you on a different plan. You know, and especially now with open enrollment coming up in the fall, it's a perfect opportunity for people to start looking at that.
You're absolutely right. I can tell you in my practice, I have at least three women who are in their late 80s and maybe two, three elderly in their 70s and 80s who have to make choices between food and rent and medications. They are in my practice now.
Right. One well, of the if things, they're from Annmary, send them my way.
Yes.
I'll help them.
And that is something that it is important that you mention this on the television, way to get help. It is important that this word goes out, because a lot of people really do not know where to seek help. And a lot of people really don't know. Remember, they are isolated in their homes. They may be watching regular television, but they're not listening to the radio or reading the newspaper.
Right.
So somehow we have to make an effort to reach them. And I think that is where all this beautiful work that you're doing will come
right
in so handy.
And I think that's what people need to know, is that either myself or Doreen, our outreach worker, will mm-hmm. go into people's homes. Mm-hmm. So that, they, you know, coming into, even though we're going to have this beautiful new facility, mm-hmm. like you said, though, coming out of the house is taxing. So, you know, we'll go into the house. And I think some of the other untapped benefits are the veterans. So if you're a veteran or a spouse of a veteran, you may be eligible for services through them, mm-hmm. you know, to help pay for the medications and get that treatment that you need. So, you know, and Chris and Lucy are our veterans agent, will also go out to the house. Mm-hmm. So, you know, as you, you know, are having a harder time going to the mailbox and you're thinking, oh, no, I got to go in there. Well, you don't with us. Mm-hmm. We'll come to you. And that's really a nice, you know, feature that we have in Amesbury, that we'll go mm-hmm. out there. But there's so much that you have to offer, and I, you know, and I encourage people mm-hmm. if they're having health issues to mm-hmm. reach out to the physician. You know, you have a practice that, you know, mm-hmm. you see patients at, but really to communicate that even with their children, because mm-hmm. sometimes talking to a physician can be intimidating, you know, and you know, maybe taking that step and talking to a family member.
Yes, you know, you bring some very important points. As resources are shrinking, as the cost of living is going up, we really have to go back to the basics again. You know, it's the family that counts. It's the community that counts. It is the togetherness that what brings us together. One other mentioned thing that I thought before was that, let's not start stereotyping that elderly or you can't walk, all that. There are 80-year-olds and 90-year-olds probably performing better than you and I right now.
Absolutely.
And I think we have
one
to make sure.
One of our people that is out there in the sound booth
yes.
is a runner.
Yes,
and
yes.
And he can outrun me any day.
And in a marathon, somebody 80-year-old ran by me. So I know my limitations very well also.
Right.
So coming back to that whole concept of community and family, I think as physicians, as community organizers, we really have to get the family involved. We really have to find ways to get them partake in the care of our 70-year-olds and 80-year-olds and 90. Remember, this is a chain reaction. What you do now is what your children do for you when you're at that stage.
Right.
So that spirit has to somehow come back again. Over the past 30, 40 years, the family's dispersed, you know. You're living here.
Across the world.
Yes. But more so in the U.S., if you go to the Southeast Asia or China, they still huddle together.
Mm-hmm.
So that because of the resources, they have to combine their resources and live together. But here, because there was so much affluency everywhere, it was easy to move away. So much so that only 15 to 20% of the families were living combined by the time the 2010 arrived. But now the trend is reversing. Now about, I think the recent statistics, 31% of the families are moving together now because of the cost of living, because of the problem with jobs, all of that
right.
stuff, yeah.
Well, and I lived in New Mexico for 4.5 years and I moved back so that, you know, I could be here mm-hmm. close to my family as we raise our young children,
yes.
you know. And I do think that, you know, we have a caregiver support program through the Council on Aging, and that's important too.
Mm-hmm.
So even if you are, you know, the family member who's watching this show right now, and you have your loved one out of state, then you can go ahead and join our family caregiver mm-hmm. program. But I gotta say, we have run out of time, so I'm very happy to have had you with us today. I encourage people to come and meet with you in August and check out our newsletter and find out when you're coming.
No, I'm so thankful for you to allow me to have this opportunity. I'm really thankful. Thank you.
Thank you, have a great day. And thank you for joining us.